The AX system Tesla developed is still the standard today, but after patents were filed in his name, other scientists came forward to take credit for the invention, claiming that they had laid the groundwork for him. His name was lost in the shuffle, and the public came to associate the invention with Westinghouse himself. A year later, Westinghouse was caught in a takeover bid from J.P. Morgan, who made him rescind the generous royalty contract he had signed with Tesla. Westinghouse explained to the scientist that his company would not survive if it had to pay him his full royalties. He persuaded Tesla to accept a buyout of his patents for $216,000, a large sum, no doubt, but far less than the $12 million they were worth at the time. The financiers had divested Tesla of the riches, the patents, and essentially the credit for the greatest invention of his career. The name of Guglielmo Marconi is forever linked with the invention of radio, but few know that in producing his invention he broadcast a signal across the English Channel in 1899. Marconi made use of a patent Tesla had filed in 1897, and that his work depended on Tesla's research. Once again, Tesla received no money and no credit. Tesla invented an induction motor as well as the AC power system, and he is the real father of radio. Yet none of these discoveries bear his name. As an old man, he lived in poverty. In 1917, during his later impoverished years, Tesla was told he was to receive the Edison Medal of the American Institute of Electrical Engineers. He turned the medal down. "You propose," he said, "to honor me with a medal which I could pin upon my coat and strut for a vain hour before the members of your institute. You would decorate my body and continue to let starve, for failure to supply recognition, my mind and its creative products, which have supplied the foundation upon which the major portion of your institute exists." Interpretation. Many harbor the illusion that science, dealing with facts as it does, is beyond the petty rivalries that trouble the rest of the world. Nikola Tesla was one of those. He believed science had nothing to do with politics, and claimed not to care for fame and riches. As he grew older, though, this ruined his scientific work. Not associated with any particular discovery, he could attract no investors to his many ideas. While he pondered great inventions for the future, others stole the patents he had already developed and got the glory for themselves. He wanted to do everything on his own, but merely exhausted and impoverished himself in the process. Edison was Tesla's polar opposite. He wasn't actually much of a scientific thinker or inventor. He once said that he had no need to be a mathematician because he could always hire one. That was Edison's main method. He was really a businessman and publicist, spotting the trends and the opportunities that were out there, then hiring the best in the field to do the work for him. If he had to, he would steal from his competitors. Yet his name is much better known than Tesla's, and is associated with more inventions. To be sure, if the hunter relies on the security of the carriage, utilizes the legs of the six horses, and makes Wang Liang hold their reins, then he will not tire himself and will find it easy to overtake swift animals. Now supposing he discarded the advantage of the carriage, gave up the useful legs of the horses and the skill of Wang Liang, and alighted to run after the animals, then even though his legs were as quick as Lu Qi's, he would not be in time to overtake the animals. In fact, if good horses and strong carriages are taken into use, then mere bondmen and bondwomen will be good enough to catch the animals. Han Fei Zhu, Chinese philosopher, 3rd century BC. The lesson is twofold. First, the credit for an invention or creation is as important, if not more important, than the invention itself. You must secure the credit for yourself and keep others from stealing it away, or from piggybacking on your hard work. To accomplish this, you must always be vigilant and ruthless, keeping your creation quiet until you can be sure there are no vultures circling overhead. Second, learn to take advantage of other people's work to further your own cause. Time is precious and life is short. If you try to do it all on your own, you run yourself ragged, waste energy, and burn yourself out. It is far better to conserve your forces, pounce on the work others have done, and find a way to make it your own. Everybody steals in commerce and industry. I've stolen a lot myself, but I know how to steal. Thomas Edison, 1847 to 1931. Keys to power. The world of power has the dynamics of the jungle. There are those who live by hunting and killing, and there are also vast numbers of creatures, hyenas, vultures, who live off the hunting of others. These latter, less imaginative types are often incapable of doing the work that is essential for the creation of power. They understand early on, though, that if they wait long enough, They can always find another animal to do the work for them. Do not be naive. At this very moment, while you are slaving away on some project, there are vultures circling above trying to figure out a way to survive and even thrive off your creativity. It is useless to complain about this, or to wear yourself ragged with bitterness, as Tesla did. Better to protect yourself and join the game. Once you have established a power base, become a vulture yourself, and save yourself a lot of time and energy. A hen who had lost her sight, and was accustomed to scratching up the earth in search of food, although blind, still continued to scratch away most diligently. Of what use was it to the industrial use fool? Another sharp-sighted hen who spared her tender feet never moved from her side, and enjoyed, without scratching, the fruit of the other's labor. For as often as the blind hen scratched up a barley corn, her watchful companion devoured it. Fables, Go Eat Cold Lessing, 1729-1781. Of the two poles of this game, one can be illustrated by the example of the explorer Vasco Nunez de Balboa. Balboa had an obsession: the discovery of El Dorado, a legendary city of vast riches. Early in the 16th century, after countless hardships and brushes with death, he found evidence of a great and wealthy empire to the south of Mexico, in present-day Peru. By conquering this empire, the Incan, and seizing its gold, he would make himself the next Cortes. The problem was that even as he made this discovery, word of it spread among hundreds of other conquistadors. He did not understand that half the game was keeping it quiet, and carefully watching those around him. A few years after he discovered the location of the Incan Empire, a soldier in his own army, Francisco Pizarro, helped to get him beheaded for treason. Pizarro went on to take what Balboa had spent so many years trying to find. The other pole is that of the artist Peter Paul Rubens, who, late in his career, found himself deluged with requests for paintings. He created a system. In his large studio he employed dozens of outstanding painters, one specializing in robes, another in backgrounds, and so on. He created a vast production line in which a large number of canvases would be worked on at the same time. When an important client visited the studio, Rubens would shoo his hired painters out for the day. While the client watched from a balcony, Rubens would work at an incredible pace, with unbelievable energy. The client would leave in awe of this prodigious man, who could paint so many masterpieces in so short a time. This is the essence of the law: learn to get others to do the work for you while you take the credit, and you appear to be of godlike strength and power. If you think it important to do all the work yourself, you will never get far, and you will suffer the fate of the Balboas and Teslas of the world. Find people with the skills and creativity you lack. Either hire them, while putting your own name on top of theirs, or find a way to take their work and make it your own. Their creativity thus becomes yours, and you seem a genius to the world. There is another application of this law that does not require the parasitic use of your contemporaries' labor, used a past, a vast storehouse of knowledge and wisdom. Isaac Newton called this standing on the shoulders of giants. He meant that in making his discoveries he had built on the achievements of others. A great part of his aura of genius, he knew, was attributable to his shrewd ability to make the most of the insights of ancient, medieval, and Renaissance scientists. Shakespeare borrowed plots, characterizations, and even dialogue from Plutarch, among other writers, for he knew that nobody surpassed Plutarch in the writing of subtle psychology and witty quotes. How many later writers have in their turn borrowed from plagiarized Shakespeare? We all know how few of today's politicians write their own speeches. Their own words would not win them a single vote. Their eloquence and wit, whatever there is of it, they owe to a speechwriter. Other people do the work. They take the credit. The upside of this is that it is a kind of power that is available to everyone. Learn to use the knowledge of the past and you will look like a genius, even when you are really just a clever borrower. Writers who have delved into human nature, ancient masters of strategy, historians of human stupidity and folly, kings and queens who have learned the hard way how to handle the burdens of power, their knowledge is gathering dust, waiting for you to come and stand on their shoulders. Though it can be your wit, their skill can be your skill, and they will never come around to tell people how unoriginal you really are. You can slog through life, making endless mistakes, wasting time and energy trying to do things from your own experience. Or you can use the armies of the past. As Bismarck once said, fools say that they learn by experience. I prefer to profit by others' experience. Image, the vulture. Of all the creatures in the jungle, he has it the easiest. The hard work of others becomes his work. Their failure to survive becomes his nourishment. Keep an eye on the vulture while you are hard at work. He is circling above. Do not fight him, join him. Authority. There is much to be known, life is short, and life is not life without knowledge. It is therefore an excellent device to acquire knowledge from everybody. Thus, by the sweat of another's brow, you win the reputation of being an oracle. Balthazar Gratian, 1601-1658. Reversal. There are times when taking the credit for work that others have done is not the wise course. If your power is not firmly enough established, you will seem to be pushing people out of the limelight. To be a brilliant exploiter of talent, your position must be unshakable, or you will be accused of deception. Be sure you know when letting other people share the credit serves your purpose. It is especially important to not be greedy when you have a master above you. President Richard Nixon's historic visit to the People's Republic of China was originally his idea, but it might never have come off but for the deft diplomacy of Henry Kissinger. Nor would it have been as successful without Kissinger's skills. Still, when the time came to take credit, Kissinger adroitly let Nixon take the lion's share. Knowing that the truth would come out later, he was careful not to jeopardize his standing in the short term by hogging the limelight. Kissinger played the game expertly. He took credit for the work of those below him while graciously giving credit for his own labors to those above. That is the way to play the game. Law 8. Make other people come to you. Use bait if necessary. Judgment. When you force the other person to act, you are the one in control. It is always better to make your opponent come to you, abandoning his own plans in the process. Lure him with fabulous gains, then attack. You hold the cards. Observance of the law. At the Congress of Vienna in 1814, the major powers of Europe gathered to carve up the remains of Napoleon's fallen empire. The city was full of gaiety and the balls were the most splendid in memory. Hovering over the proceedings, however, was the shadow of Napoleon himself. Instead of being executed or exiled far away, he had been sent to the island of Elba, not far from the coast of Italy. Even imprisoned on an island, a man as bold and creative as Napoleon Bonaparte made everyone nervous. The Austrians plotted to kill him on Elba, but decided it was too risky. Alexander I, Russia's temperamental Tsar, heightened the anxiety by throwing a fit during the Congress when a part of Poland was denied him. Beware, I shall loose the monster, he threatened. Everyone knew he meant Napoleon. Of all the statesmen gathered in Vienna, only Talleyrand, Napoleon's former foreign minister, seemed calm and unconcerned. It was as if he knew something the others did not. Meanwhile, on the island of Elba, Napoleon's life was a mockery of his previous glory. As Elba's king, he had been allowed to form a court. There was a cook, a wardrobe mistress, an official pianist, and a handful of courtiers. All this was designed to humiliate Napoleon, and it seemed to work. That winter, however, there occurred a series of events so strange and dramatic they might have been scripted in a play. Elba was surrounded by British ships, their cannons covering all possible exit points. Yet somehow, in broad daylight on February 26, 1815, a ship with 900 men on board picked up Napoleon and put to sea. The English gave chase, but the ship got away. This almost impossible escape astonished the public throughout Europe and terrified the statesmen at the Congress of Vienna. Although it would have been safer to leave Europe, Napoleon not only chose to return to France, he raised the odds by marching on Paris with a tiny army, in hopes of recapturing the throne. His strategy worked. People of all classes threw themselves at his feet. An army under Marshal Ney sped from Paris to arrest him, but when the soldiers saw their beloved former leader, they changed sides. Napoleon was declared emperor again. Volunteers swelled the ranks of his new army. Delirium swept the country. In Paris, crowds went wild. The king who had replaced Napoleon fled the country. For the next 100 days, Napoleon ruled France. Soon, however, the giddiness subsided. France was bankrupt, its resources nearly exhausted, and there was little Napoleon could do about this. At the Battle of Waterloo, in June of that year, he was finally defeated for good. This time his enemies had learned their lesson. They exiled him to the barren island of St. Helena, off the west coast of Africa. There he had no more hope of escape. Interpretation. Only years later did the facts of Napoleon's dramatic escape from Elba come to light. Before he decided to attempt this bold move, visitors to his court had told him that he was more popular in France than ever, and that the country would embrace him again. One of these visitors was Austria's General Roller, who convinced Napoleon that if he escaped, The European powers, England included, would welcome him back into power. Napoleon was tipped off that the English would let him go, and indeed his escape occurred in the middle of the afternoon, in full view of English spyglasses. What Napoleon did not know was that there was a man behind it all, pulling the strings, and that this man was his former minister, Talleyrand. And Talleyrand was doing all this not to bring back the glory days but to crush Napoleon once and for all. Considering the emperor's ambition unsettling to Europe's stability, he had turned against him long ago. When Napoleon was exiled to Elba, Talleyrand had protested Napoleon should be sent farther away, he argued, or Europe would never have peace. But no one listened. Instead of pushing his opinion, Talleyrand bided his time. Working quietly, he eventually won over Castlereagh and Metternich, the foreign ministers of England and Austria. Together these men baited Napoleon into escaping. Even Koller's visit, to whisper the promise of glory in the exile's ear, was part of the plan. Like a master card player, Talleyrand figured everything out in advance. He knew Napoleon would fall into the trap he had set. He also foresaw that Napoleon would lead the country into a war, which, given France's weakened condition, could only last a few months. One diplomat in Vienna, who understood that Talleyrand was behind it all, said, "He has set the house ablaze in order to save it from the plague. When I have laid bait for deer, I don't shoot it the first doe that comes to sniff, but wait until the whole herd has gathered round." Otto von Bismarck, 1815-1898. Keys to power. How many times has this scenario played itself out in history? An aggressive leader initiates a series of bold moves that begin by bringing him much power. Slowly, however, his power reaches a peak, and soon everything turns against him. His numerous enemies band together, trying to maintain his power. He exhausts himself going in this direction and that, and inevitably he collapses. The reason for this pattern is that the aggressive person is rarely in full control. He cannot see more than a couple of moves ahead, cannot see the consequences of this bold move or that one. Because he is constantly being forced to react to the moves of his ever-growing host of enemies, and to the unforeseen consequences of his own rash actions, his aggressive energy is turned against him. In the realm of power, you must ask yourself, what is the point of chasing here and there, trying to solve problems and defeat my enemies, if I never feel in control? Why am I always having to react to events instead of directing them? The answer is simple: your idea of power is wrong. You have mistaken aggressive action for effective action. And most often the most effective action is to stay back, keep calm, and let others be frustrated by the traps you lay for them, playing for long-term power rather than quick victory. Remember, the essence of power is the ability to keep the initiative, to get others to react to your moves, to keep your opponent and those around you on the defensive. When you make other people come to you, you suddenly become the one controlling the situation, and the one who has control has power. Two things must happen to place you in this position. You yourself must learn to master your emotions, and never to be influenced by anger. Meanwhile, however, you must play on people's natural tendency to react angrily when pushed and baited. In the long run, the ability to make others come to you is a weapon far more powerful than any tool of aggression. Study how Talleyrand, the master of the art, performed this delicate trick. First, he overcame the urge to try to convince his fellow statesmen that they needed to banish Napoleon far away. It is only natural to want to persuade people by pleading your case, imposing your will with words. But this often turns against you. Few of Talleyrand's contemporaries believe Napoleon was still a threat, so that if he had spent a lot of energy trying to convince them, he would only have made himself look foolish. Instead, he held his tongue and his emotions in check. Most important of all, he laid Napoleon a sweet and irresistible trap. He knew the man's weakness, his impetuosity, his need for glory and the love of the masses, and he played all this to perfection. When Napoleon went for the bait, there was no danger that he might succeed and turn the tables on Talleyrand, who better than anyone knew France's depleted state. And even had Napoleon been able to overcome these difficulties, the likelihood of his success would have been greater were he able to choose his time and place of action. By setting the proper trap, Talleyrand took the time and place into his own hands. All of us have only so much energy, and there is a moment when our energies are at their peak. When you make the other person come to you, he wears himself out, wasting his energy on the trip. In the year 1905, Russia and Japan were at war. The Japanese had only recently begun to modernize their warships, so that the Russians had a stronger navy, but by spreading false information the Japanese Marshal Togo Hihashiro baited the Russians into leaving their docks in the Baltic Sea, making them believe they could wipe out the Japanese fleet in one swift attack. The Russian fleet could not reach Japan by the quickest route through the Strait of Gibraltar and then the Suez Canal into the Indian Ocean because these were controlled by the British, and Japan was an ally of Great Britain. They had to go around the Cape of Good Hope, at the southern tip of Africa, adding over more than 6,000 miles to the voyage. Once the fleet passed the Cape, the Japanese spread another false story, they were sailing to launch a counterattack. So the Russians made the entire journey to Japan on combat alert. By the time they arrived, their seamen were tense, exhausted, and overworked, while the Japanese had been waiting at their ease. Despite the odds and their lack of experience in modern naval warfare, the Japanese crushed the Russians. One added benefit of making the opponent come to you, as the Japanese discovered with the Russians, is that it forces him to operate in your territory. Being on hostile ground will make him nervous and often he will rush his actions and make mistakes. For negotiations or meetings, it is always wise to lure others into your territory, or the territory of your choice. You have your bearings. While they see nothing familiar and are subtly placed on the defensive, manipulation is a dangerous game. Once someone suspects he is being manipulated, it becomes harder and harder to control him. But when you make your opponent come to you, you create the illusion that he is controlling the situation. He does not feel the strings that pull him, just as Napoleon imagined that he himself was the master of his daring escape and return to power. Everything depends on the sweetness of your bait. If your trap is attractive enough, the turbulence of your enemy's emotions and desires will blind them to reality. The greedier they become, the more they can be led around. The great 19th century robber Baron Daniel Drew was a master at playing the stock market. When he wanted a particular stock to be bought or sold, driving prices up or down, he rarely resorted to the direct approach. One of his tricks was to hurry through an exclusive club near Wall Street, obviously on his way to the stock exchange, and to pull out his customary red bandana to wipe his perspiring brow. A slip of paper would fall from this bandana that he would pretend not to notice. The club's members were always trying to foresee Drew's moves, and they would pounce on the paper, which invariably seemed to contain an inside tip on a stock. Word would spread, and members would buy or sell the stock in droves, playing perfectly into Drew's hands. If you can get other people to dig their own graves, why sweat yourself? Pickpockets work this to perfection. The key to picking a pocket is knowing which pocket contains the wallet. Experienced pickpockets often ply their trade in train stations and other places where there is a clearly marked sign reading "Beware of pickpockets." Passers-by seeing the sign invariably feel for their wallet to make sure it is still there. For the watching pickpockets, this is like shooting fish in a barrel. Pickpockets have even been known to place their own "Beware of pickpockets" signs to ensure their success. When you are making people come to you, it is sometimes better to let them know you are forcing their hand. You give up deception for overt manipulation. The psychological ramifications are profound. The person who makes others come to him appears powerful and demands respect. Filippo Brunelleschi, the great Renaissance artist and architect, was a great practitioner of the art of making others come to him as a sign of his power. On one occasion he had been engaged to repair the dome of the Santa Maria del Fiore Cathedral in Florence. The commission was important and prestigious, but when the city officials hired a second man, Lorenzo Abati, to work with Brunelleschi, the great artist brooded in secret. He knew that Abati had gotten the job through his connections, and that he would do none of the work and get half the credit. At a critical moment of the construction, then, Brunelleschi suddenly developed a mysterious illness. He had to stop work, but pointed out to city officials that they had hired Abati, who should have been able to continue the work on his own. Soon it became clear that Abati was useless and the officials came begging to Brunelleschi. He ignored them, insisting that Abati should finish the project, until finally they realized the problem. They fired Abati. By some miracle, Brunelleschi recovered within days. He did not have to throw a tantrum or make a fool of himself. He simply practiced the art of making others come to you. If on one occasion you make it a point of dignity that others must come to you and you succeed, they will continue to do so even after you stop trying. Image: the hunted bear trap. The bear hunter does not chase his prey. A bear that knows it is hunted is nearly impossible to catch and is ferocious if cornered. Instead, the hunter lays traps baited with honey. He does not exhaust himself and risk his life in pursuit. He baits, then waits. Authority. Good warriors make other come to them, and do not go to others. This is the principle of emptiness and fullness of others and self. When you induce opponents to come to you, then their force is always empty. As long as you do not go to them, your force is always full. Attacking emptiness with fullness is like throwing stones on eggs. Zhang Yu, 11th century commentator on the art of war. Reversal. Although it is generally the wiser policy to make others exhaust themselves chasing you, there are opposite cases where striking suddenly and aggressively at the enemy so demoralizes him that his energies sink. Instead of making others come to you, you go to them, force the issue, take the lead. Fast attack can be an awesome weapon, for it forces the other person to react without the time to think or plan. With no time to think, people make errors of judgment, and are thrown on the defensive. This tactic is the obverse of waiting and baiting, but it serves the same function. You make your enemy respond on your terms. Men like Ser Borgia and Napoleon used the element of speed to intimidate and control. A rapid and unforeseen move is terrifying and demoralizing. You must choose your tactics depending on the situation. If you have time on your side, and know that you and your enemies are at least at equal strength, then deplete their strength by making them come to you. If time is against you, your enemies are weaker, and waiting will only give them the chance to recover. Give them no such chance. Strike quickly and they have nowhere to go. As the boxer Joe Louis put it, he can run, but he can't hide. Law 9. Win through your actions, never through argument. Judgment. Any momentary triumph you think you have gained through argument is really a Pyrrhic victory. The resentment and ill will you stir up is stronger and lasts longer than any momentary change of opinion. It is much more powerful to get others to agree with you through your actions, without saying a word. Demonstrate. Do not explicate. Transgression of the law. In 131 BC, the Roman consul Publius Crassus Dives Muianus, laying siege to the Greek town of Pergamus, found himself in need of a battering ram to force through the town's walls. He had seen a couple of hefty ships' masts in a shipyard in Athens a few days before, and he ordered that the larger of these be sent to him immediately. The military engineer in Athens who received the order felt certain that the consul really wanted the smaller of the masts. He argued endlessly with the soldiers who delivered the request. The smaller mast, he told them, was much better suited to the task, and indeed it would be easier to transport. The soldiers warned the engineer that their master was not a man to argue with, but he insisted that the smaller mast would be the only one that would work with the machine that he was constructing to go with it. He drew diagram after diagram, and went so far as to say that he was the expert and they had no clue what they were talking about. The soldiers knew their leader and at last convinced the engineer that it would be better to swallow his expertise and obey. After they left, though, the engineer thought about it some more. What was the point, he asked himself, in obeying an order that would lead to failure? And so he sent the smaller mast, confident that the consul would see how much more effective it was and rewards him justly. When the smaller mast arrived, Muianus asked his soldiers for an explanation. They described to him how the engineer had argued endlessly for the smaller mast, but had finally promised to send the larger one. Muianus went into a rage. He could not concentrate on the siege, or consider the importance of breaching the walls before the town received reinforcements. All he could think about was the impudent engineer, whom he ordered to be brought to him immediately. Arriving a few days later, the engineer gladly explained to the consul, one more time, the reasons for the smaller mast. He went on and on, using the same arguments he had made with the soldiers. He said it was wise to listen to experts in these matters, and if the attack was only tried with the battering ram he had sent, the consul would not regret it. Muianus let him finish, then had him stripped naked before the soldiers and flogged and scourged with rods until he died. The Sultan and the Vizier. The Vizier had served his master for some 30 years and was known and admired for his loyalty, truthfulness, and devotion to God. His honesty, however, had made him many enemies in the court, who spread stories of his duplicity and perfidy. They worked on the Sultan day in and day out until he too came to distrust the innocent vizier and finally ordered the man who had served him so well to be put to death. In this realm, those condemned to death were tied up and thrown into the pen where the Sultan kept his fiercest hunting dogs. The dogs would promptly tear the victim to pieces. Before being thrown to the dogs, however, the vizier asked for one last request. I would like 10 days respite, he said, so that I can pay my debts, collect any money due to me, return items that people have put in my care, and share out my goods among the members of my family and my children and appoint a guardian for them. After receiving a guarantee that the vizier would not try to escape, the sultan granted this request. The vizier hurried home, collected 100 gold pieces, then paid a visit to the huntsman who looked after the sultan's dogs. He offered this man the 100 gold pieces and said, "Let me look after the dogs for 10 days. The huntsman agreed, and for the next 10 days the vizier cared for the beasts with great attention, grooming them well and feeding them handsomely. By the end of the 10 days they were eating out of his hand. On the 11th day the vizier was called before the sultan, the charges were repeated, and the sultan watched as the vizier was tied up and thrown to the dogs. Yet when the beasts saw him, they ran up to him with wagging tails. They nibbled affectionately at his shoulders and began playing with him. The sultan and the other witnesses were amazed, and the sultan asked the vizier why the dogs had spared his life. The vizier replied, "I have looked after these dogs for 10 days. The sultan has seen the result for himself. I have looked after you for 30 years, and what is the result? I am condemned to death on the strength of accusations brought by my enemies." The sultan blushed with shame. He not only pardoned the vizier but gave him a fine set of clothes and handed over to him the men who had slandered his reputation. The noble vizier set them free and continued to treat them with kindness. The Subtle Ruse, the Book of Arabic Wisdom and Guile, 13th century. Interpretation. The engineer, whose name has not been recorded by history, had spent his life designing masts and pillars, and was respected as the finest engineer in a city that had excelled in the science. He knew that he was right. A smaller ram would allow more speed and carry more force. Larger is not necessarily better. Of course, the consul would see his logic, and would eventually understand that science is neutral and reason superior. How could the consul possibly persist in his ignorance if the engineer showed him detailed diagrams and explained the theories behind his advice? The military engineer was the quintessence of the arguer, a type found everywhere among us. The arguer does not understand that words are never neutral, and that by arguing with a superior he impugns the intelligence of one more powerful than he. He also has no awareness of the person he is dealing with. Since each man believes that he is right, and words will rarely convince him otherwise, the arguer's reasoning falls on deaf ears. When cornered, he only argues more, digging his own grave. Once he has made the other person feel insecure and inferior in his beliefs, the eloquence of Socrates could not save the situation. It is not simply a question of avoiding an argument with those who stand above you. We all believe we are masters in the realm of opinions and reasoning. You must be careful, then, learn to demonstrate the correctness of your ideas indirectly. Observance of the law. In 1502, in Florence, Italy, an enormous block of marble stood in the works department of the Church of Santa Maria del Fiore. It had once been a magnificent piece of raw stone, but an unskillful sculptor had mistakenly bored a hole through it where there should have been a figure's legs, generally mutilating it. Piero Soderini, Florence's mayor, had contemplated trying to save the block by commissioning Leonardo da Vinci to work on it, or some other master, but had given up, since everyone agreed that the stone had been ruined. So, despite the money that had been wasted on it, it gathered dust in the dark halls of the church. This was where things stood until some Florentine friends of the great Michelangelo decided to write to the artist, then living in Rome. He alone, they said, could do something with the marble, which was still magnificent raw material. Michelangelo traveled to Florence, examined a stone, and came to the conclusion that he could in fact carve a fine figure from it, by adapting the pose to the way the rock had been mutilated. Soderini argued that this was a waste of time, nobody could salvage such a disaster, but he finally agreed to let the artist work on it. Michelangelo decided he would depict a young David, sling in hand. Weeks later, as Michelangelo was putting the final touches on the statue, Soderini entered the studio. Fancying himself a bit of a connoisseur, he studied the huge work, and told Michelangelo that while he thought it was magnificent, the nose, he judged, was too big. Michelangelo realized that Soderini was standing in a place right under the giant figure and did not have the proper perspective. Without a word, he gestured for Soderini to follow him up the scaffolding. Reaching the nose, he picked up his chisel, as well as a bit of marble dust that lay on the planks. With Soderini just a few feet below him on the scaffolding, Michelangelo started to tap lightly with the chisel, letting the bits of dust he had gathered in his hand to fall little by little. He actually did nothing to change the nose, but gave every appearance of working on it. After a few minutes of this charade, he stood aside. "Look at it now. I like it better, replied Soderini. You've made it come alive. Interpretation. Michelangelo knew that by changing the shape of the nose he might ruin the entire sculpture. Yet Soderini was a patron who prided himself on his aesthetic judgment. To offend such a man by arguing would not only gain Michelangelo nothing, it would put future commissions in jeopardy. Michelangelo was too clever to argue. His solution was to change Soderini's perspective, literally bringing him closer to the nose, without making him realize that this was the cause of his misperception. Fortunately for posterity, Michelangelo found a way to keep the perfection of the statue intact while at the same time making Soderini believe he had improved it. Such is the double power of winning through actions rather than argument. No one is offended, and your point is proven. When Apries had been deposed in the way I have described, Amasis came to the throne. He belonged to the district of Sais and was a native of the town called Saf. At first the Egyptians were inclined to be contemptuous, and did not think much of him because of his humble and undistinguished origin. But later on he cleverly brought them to heel, without having recourse to harsh measures. Amongst his innumerable treasures, he had a gold foot bath, which he and his guests used on occasion to wash their feet in. This he broke up, and with the material had a statue made to one of the gods, which he then set up in what he thought the most suitable spot in the city. The Egyptians, constantly coming upon the statue, treated it with profound reverence, and as soon as Amasis heard of the effect it had upon them, he called a meeting and revealed the fact that the deeply revered statue was once a foot bath, which they washed their feet and pissed and vomited in. He went on to say that his own case was much the same, in that once he had been only an ordinary person and was now their king. So that just as they had come to revere the transformed foot bath, so they had better pay honor and respect to him too. In this way the Egyptians were persuaded to accept him as their master. The histories. Herodotus, 5th century BC. Keys to power. In the realm of power you must learn to judge your moves by their long-term effects on other people. The problem in trying to prove a point or gain a victory through argument is that in the end you can never be certain how it affects the people you're arguing with. They may appear to agree with you politely, but inside they may resent you. Or perhaps something you said inadvertently even offended them. Words have that insidious ability to be interpreted according to the other person's mood and insecurities. Even the best argument has no solid foundation, for we have all come to distrust the slippery nature of words. And days after agreeing with someone, we often revert to our old opinion out of sheer habit. Understand this, words are a dime a dozen. Everyone knows that in the heat of an argument, we will all say anything to support our cause. We will quote the Bible, refer to unverifiable statistics. Who can be persuaded by bags of air like that? Action and demonstration are much more powerful and meaningful. They are there, before our eyes, for us to see. Yes, now the statue's nose does look just right. There are no offensive words, no possibility of misinterpretation. No one can argue with a demonstrated proof. As Balthazar Gracian remarks, the truth is generally seen, rarely heard. Sir Christopher Wren was England's version of the Renaissance man. He had mastered the sciences of mathematics, astronomy, physics, and physiology. Yet during his extremely long career as England's most celebrated architect, he was often told by his patrons to make impractical changes in his designs. Never once did he argue or offend. He had other ways of proving his point. In 1688, Wren designed a magnificent town hall for the city of Westminster. The mayor, however, was not satisfied. In fact, he was nervous. He told Wren he was afraid the second floor was not secure, and that it could all come crashing down on his office on the first floor. He demanded that Wren add two stone columns for extra support. Wren, the consummate engineer, knew that these columns would serve no purpose, and that the mayor's fears were baseless. But build them he did, and the mayor was grateful. It was only years later that workmen on a high scaffold saw that the columns stopped just short of the ceiling. They were dummies. But both men got what they wanted, the mayor could relax, and Wren knew posterity would understand that his original design worked and the columns were unnecessary. The power of demonstrating your idea is that your opponents do not get defensive, and are therefore more open to persuasion. Making them literally and physically feel your meaning is infinitely more powerful than argument. A heckler once interrupted Nikita Khrushchev in the middle of a speech in which he was denouncing the crimes of Stalin. You were a colleague of Stalin's, the heckler yelled. Why didn't you stop him then? Khrushchev apparently could not see the heckler and barked out, who said that? No hand went up. No one moved a muscle. After a few seconds of tense silence, Khrushchev finally said in a quiet voice, Now you know why I didn't stop him. Instead of just arguing that anyone facing Stalin was afraid, knowing that the slightest sign of rebellion would mean certain death, he had made them feel what it was like to face Stalin. It made them feel the paranoia, the fear of speaking up, the terror of confronting the leader, in this case Khrushchev. The demonstration was visceral and no more argument was necessary. The most powerful persuasion goes beyond action into symbol. The power of a symbol, a flag, a mythic story, a monument to some emotional event is that everyone understands you without anything being said. In 1975, when Henry Kissinger was engaged in some frustrating negotiations with the Israelis over the return of part of the Sinai Desert that they had seized in the 1967 war, he suddenly broke off a tense meeting and decided to do some sightseeing. He paid a visit to the ruins of the ancient fortress of Mazeda, known to all Israelis as the place where 700 Jewish warriors committed mass suicide in AD 73 rather than given to the Roman troops besieging them. The Israelis instantly understood the message of Kissinger's visit. He was indirectly accusing them of courting mass suicide. Although the visit did not by itself change their minds, it made them think far more seriously than any direct warning would have. Symbols like this one carry great emotional significance. When aiming for power, or trying to conserve it, always look for the indirect route, and also choose your battles carefully. If it does not matter in the long run whether the other person agrees with you or if time and their own experience will make them understand what you mean, then it is best not even to bother with the demonstration. Save your energy and walk away. God and Abraham. The Most High God had promised that he would not take Abraham's soul unless the man wanted to die and asked him to do so. When Abraham's life was drawing to a close, and God determined to seize him, he sent an angel in the guise of a decrepit old man who was almost entirely incapacitated. The old man stopped outside Abraham's door and said to him, "Oh Abraham, I would like something to eat." Abraham was amazed to hear him say this. "Die," exclaimed Abraham. "It would be better for you than to go on living in that condition." Abraham always kept food ready at his home for passing guests. So he gave the old man a bowl containing broth and meat with breadcrumbs. The old man sat down to eat. He swallowed laboriously, with great effort, and once when he took some food it dropped from his hand, scattering on the ground. "Oh Abraham," he said, "help me to eat." Abraham took the food in his hand and lifted it to the old man's lips, but it slid down his beard and over his chest. "What is your age, old man?" asked Abraham. The old man mentioned a number of years slightly greater than Abraham's old age. Then Abraham exclaimed, "O Lord our God, take me unto you before I reach this man's age and sink into the same condition as he is in now." No sooner had Abraham spoken those words than God took possession of his soul. The Subtle Ruse, the Book of Arabic Wisdom and Guile, 13th century image. The seesaw. Up and down and up and down go the arguers, getting nowhere fast. Get off the seesaw and show them your meaning without kicking or pushing. Leave them at the top and let gravity bring them gently to the ground. Authority. Never argue. In society nothing must be discussed. Give only results. Benjamin Disraeli, 1804-1881. Reversal. Verbal argument is one vital use in the realm of power, to distract and cover your tracks when you are practicing deception or are caught in a lie. In such cases it is to your advantage to argue with all the conviction you can muster. Draw the other person into an argument to distract them from your deceptive move. When caught in a lie, the more emotional and certain you appear, the less likely it seems that you are lying. This technique has saved the hide of many a con artist. Once Count Victor Lustig, swindler par excellence, had sold dozens of suckers around the country a phony box with which he claimed to be able to copy money. Discovering their mistake, the suckers generally chose not to go to the police, rather than risk the embarrassment of publicity. But one Sheriff Richards, of Remsen County, Oklahoma, was not the kind of man to accept being conned out of $10,000, and one morning he tracked Lustig down to a hotel in Chicago. Lustig heard a knock on the door. When he opened it, he was looking down the barrel of a gun. "What seems to be the problem?" he calmly asked. "You son of a bitch," yelled the sheriff. "I'm going to kill you. You conned me with that damn box of yours." Lustig feigned confusion. "You mean it's not working?" he asked. "You know it's not working," replied the sheriff. "But that's impossible," said Lustig. "There's no way it couldn't be working. Did you operate it properly?" I did exactly what you told me to do, said the sheriff. No, you must have done something wrong, said Lustig. The argument went in circles. The barrel of the gun was gently lowered. Lustig next went to phase two in the argument tactic. He pulled out a whole bunch of technical gobbledygook about the box's operation, completely beguiling the sheriff, who now appeared less sure of himself and argued less forcefully. Look, said Lustig, I'll give you your money back right now. I'll also give you written instructions on how to work the machine, and I'll come out to Oklahoma to make sure it's working properly. There's no way you can lose on that. The sheriff reluctantly agreed. To satisfy him totally, Lustig took out $100 bills and gave them to him, telling him to relax and have a fun weekend in Chicago. Calmer and a little confused, the sheriff finally left. Over the next few days, Lustig checked the paper every morning. He finally found what he was looking for, a short article reporting Sheriff Richards's arrest, trial, and conviction for passing counterfeit notes. Lustig had won the argument. The sheriff never bothered him again. Law 10. Infection. Avoid the unhappy and unlucky. Judgment. You can die from someone else's misery. Emotional states are as infectious as diseases. You may feel you are helping the drowning man, but you are only precipitating your own disaster. The unfortunate sometimes draw misfortune on themselves. They will also draw it on you. Associate with the happy and fortunate instead. Transgression of the law. Born in Limerick, Ireland, in 1818, Marie Gilbert came to Paris in the 1840s to make her fortune as a dancer and performer. Taking the name Lola Montes, her mother was of distant Spanish descent. She claimed to be a flamenco dancer from Spain. By 1845, her career was languishing, and to survive she became a courtesan, quickly one of the more successful in Paris. Only one man could salvage Lola's dancing career, Alexander Dudurier, owner of the newspaper with the largest circulation in France, and also the newspaper's drama critic. She decided to woo and conquer him. Investigating his habits, she discovered that he went riding every morning. An excellent horsewoman herself, she rode out one morning and accidentally ran into him. Soon they were riding together every day. A few weeks later, Lola moved into his apartment. For a while the two were happy together. With Dudurier's help, Lola began to revive her dancing career. Despite the risk to his social standing, Dudurier told friends he would marry her in the spring. Lola had never told him that she had eloped at age 19 with an Englishman, and was still legally married. Although Dudurier was deeply in love, his life started to slide downhill. His fortunes in business changed and influential friends began to avoid him. One night Dudurier was invited to a party, attended by some of the wealthiest young men in Paris. Lola wanted to go too, but he would not allow it. They had their first quarrel, and Dudurier attended the party by himself. There, hopelessly drunk, he insulted an influential drama critic, Jean-Baptiste Rosemond de Beauvallon, perhaps because of something the critic had said about Lola. The following morning Beauvallon challenged him to a duel. Beauvallon was one of the best pistol shots in France. Dudurier tried to apologize, but the duel took place, and he was shot and killed. Thus ended the life of one of the most promising young men of Paris society. Devastated, Lola left Paris. In 1846 Lola Montes found herself in Munich, where she decided to woo and conquer King Ludwig of Bavaria. The best way to Ludwig, she discovered, was through his aide-de-camp, Count Otto von Richberg, a man with a fondness for pretty girls. One day when the Count was breakfasting at an outdoor cafe, Lola rode by on her horse, was accidentally thrown from the saddle, and landed at Richberg's feet. The Count rushed to help her and was enchanted. He promised to introduce her to Ludwig. Richberg arranged an audience with the King for Lola, but when she arrived in the anteroom, she could hear the king saying he was too busy to meet a favor-seeking stranger. Lola pushed aside the sentries and entered his room anyway. In the process, the front of her dress somehow got torn, perhaps by her, perhaps by one of the sentries, and to the astonishment of all, most especially the king, her bare breasts were brazenly exposed. Lola was granted her audience with Ludwig. 55 hours later she made her debut on the Bavarian stage. The reviews were terrible, but that did not stop Ludwig from arranging more performances. A nut found itself carried by a crow to the top of a tall campanile, and by falling into a crevice succeeded in escaping its dread fate. It then besought the wall to shelter it, by appealing to it by the grace of God, and praising its height, and the beauty and noble tone of us bells. Alas, it went on, as I have not been able to drop beneath the green branches of my old father and to lie on the fallow earth covered by his fallen leaves, Do you, at least, not abandon me? When I found myself in the beak of the cruel crow, I made a vow that if I escaped I would end my life in a little hole. At these words, the wall, moved with compassion, was content to shelter the nut in the spot where it had fallen. Within a short time, the nut burst open. Its roots reached in between the crevices of the stones and began to push them apart. Its shoots pressed up toward the sky. They soon rose above the building, and as the twisted roots grew thicker, they began to thrust the walls apart and force the ancient stones from their old places. Then the wall, too late and in vain, bewailed the cause of its destruction, and in short time it fell in ruin. Leonardo da Vinci, 1452-1519. Ludwig was, in his own words, bewitched by Lola. He started to appear in public with her on his arm, and then he bought and furnished an apartment for her on one of Munich's most fashionable boulevards. Although he had been known as a miser, and was not given to flights of fancy, he started to shower Lola with gifts and to write poetry for her. Now his favored mistress, she catapulted to fame and fortune overnight. Lola began to lose her sense of proportion. One day when she was out riding, an elderly man rode ahead of her, a bit too slowly for her liking. Unable to pass him, she began to slash him with her riding crop. On another occasion she took her dog, unleashed, out for a stroll. The dog attacked a passerby, but instead of helping the man get the dog away, she whipped him with a leash. Incidents like this infuriated the stolid citizens of Bavaria, but Ludwig stood by Lola and even had her naturalized as a Bavarian citizen. The king's entourage tried to wake him to the dangers of the affair, but those who criticized Lola were summarily fired. In his own time, Simon Thomas was a great doctor. I remember that I happened to meet him one day at the home of a rich old consumptive. He told his patient when discussing ways to cure him that one means was to provide occasions for me to enjoy his company. He could then fix his eyes on the freshness of my countenance and his thoughts on the overflowing cheerfulness and vigor of my young manhood. By filling all his senses with the flower of my youth, his condition might improve. He forgot to add that mine might get worse. Montaigne, 1533-1592. While Bavarians who had loved their king now outwardly disrespected him, Lola was made a countess, had a new palace built for herself, and began to dabble in politics, advising Ludwig on policy. She was the most powerful force in the kingdom. Her influence in the king's cabinet continued to grow, and she treated the other ministers with disdain. As a result, riots broke out throughout the realm. A once peaceful land was virtually in the grip of civil war, and students everywhere were chanting, "Raus mit Lola!" Many things are said to be infectious. Sleepiness can be infectious, and yawning as well. In large-scale strategy, when the enemy is agitated and shows an inclination to rush, do not mind in the least. Make a show of complete calmness, and the enemy will be taken by this and will become relaxed. You infect their spirit. You can infect them with a carefree, drunk-like spirit, with boredom, or even weakness. A Book of Five Rings, Miyamoto Musashi, 17th century. By February of 1848, Ludwig was finally unable to withstand the pressure. With great sadness, he ordered Lola to leave Bavaria immediately. She left, but not until she was paid off. For the next 5 weeks, the Bavarians' wrath was turned against their formerly beloved king. In March of that year, he was forced to abdicate. Lola Montes moved to England. More than anything, she needed respectability, and despite being married, she still had not arranged a divorce from the Englishman she had wed years before. She set her sights on George Trafford Heald, a promising young army officer who was the son of an influential barrister. Although he was 10 years younger than Lola, and could have chosen a wife among the prettiest and wealthiest young girls of English society, Heald fell under her spell. They were married in 1849. Soon arrested on the charge of bigamy, she skipped bail, and she and Heald made their way to Spain. They quarreled horribly, and on one occasion Lola slashed him with a knife. Finally, she drove him away. Returning to England, he found he had lost his position in the army. Ostracized from English society, he moved to Portugal, where he lived in poverty. After a few months, his short life ended in a boating accident. A few years later, the man who published Lola Montes's autobiography went bankrupt. In 1853, Lola moved to California, where she met and married a man named Pat Hull. Their relationship was as stormy as all the others, and she left Hull for another man. He took to drink and fell into a deep depression that lasted until he died, 4 years later, still a relatively young man. At the age of 41, Lola gave away her clothes and finery and turned to God. She toured America, lecturing on religious topics, Dressed in white and wearing a halo-like white headgear, she died 2 years later, in 1861. Regard no foolish man as cultured, though you may reckon a gifted man as wise. And esteem no ignorant abstainer a true ascetic. Do not consort with fools, especially those who consider themselves wise, and be not self-satisfied with your own ignorance. Let your intercourse be only with men of good repute, for it is by such association that men themselves attain to good repute. Do you not observe how sesame oil is mingled with roses or violets, and how, when it has been for some time in association with roses or violets, it ceases to be sesame oil and is called oil of roses or oil of violets? A mirror for princes. Kai Kaus ibn Iskander, 11th century. Interpretation. Lola Montes attracted men with her wiles, but her power over them went beyond the sexual. It was through the force of her character that she kept her lovers enthralled. Men were sucked into the maelstrom she churned up around her. They felt confused, upset, but the strength of the emotions she stirred also made them feel more alive. As is often the case with infection, the problems would only arise over time. Lola's inherent instability would begin to get under her lover's skin. They would find themselves drawn into her problems, but their emotional attachment to her would make them want to help her. This was the crucial point of the disease, for Lola Montes could not be helped. Her problems were too deep. Once the lover identified with them, he was lost. He would find himself embroiled in quarrels. The infection would spread to his family and friends, or, in the case of Ludwig, to an entire nation. The only solution would be to cut her off, or suffer an eventual collapse. The infecting character type is not restricted to women. It has nothing to do with gender. It stems from an inward instability that radiates outward, drawing disaster upon itself. There is almost a desire to destroy and unsettle. You could spend a lifetime studying the pathology of infecting characters, but don't waste your time, just learn the lesson. When you suspect you are in the presence of an infector, don't argue, don't try to help, don't pass the person on to your friends, or you will become enmeshed. Flee the infector's presence or suffer the consequences. Yon Cassius has a lean and hungry look. He thinks too much. I do not know the man I should avoid so soon as that. Spare Cassius. Such men as he be never at heart's ease whilst they behold a greater than themselves, and therefore are they very dangerous. Julius Caesar, William Shakespeare, 1564-1616. Keys to power. Those misfortunates among us who have been brought down by circumstances beyond their control deserve all the help and sympathy we can give them. But there are others who are not born to misfortune or unhappiness, but who draw it upon themselves by their destructive actions and unsettling effect on others. It would be a great thing if we could raise them up, change their patterns, but more often than not it is their patterns that end up getting inside and changing us. The reason is simple: humans are extremely susceptible to the moods, emotions, and even the ways of thinking of those with whom they spend their time. The incurably unhappy and unstable have a particularly strong infecting power because their characters and emotions are so intense. They often present themselves as victims, making it difficult, at first, to see their miseries as self-inflicted. Before you realize the real nature of their problems, you have been infected by them. Understand this: in the game of power, the people you associate with are critical. The risk of associating with infectors is that you will waste valuable time and energy trying to free yourself through a kind of guilt by association. You will also suffer in the eyes of others. Never underestimate the dangers of infection. There are many kinds of infector to be aware of, but one of the most insidious is the sufferer from chronic dissatisfaction. Cassius, the Roman conspirator against Julius Caesar, had the discontent that comes from deep envy. He simply could not endure the presence of anyone of greater talent. Probably because Caesar sensed the man's interminable sourness, he passed him up for the position of first praetorship, and gave the position to Brutus instead. Cassius brooded and brooded, his hatred for Caesar becoming pathological. Brutus himself, a devoted Republican, disliked Caesar's dictatorship. Had he had the patience to wait, he would have become the first man in Rome after Caesar's death, and could have undone the evil that the leader had wrought. But Cassius infected him with his own rancor, bending his ear daily with tales of Caesar's evil. He finally won Brutus over to the conspiracy. It was the beginning of a great tragedy. How many misfortunes could have been avoided had Brutus learned to fear the power of infection? There is only one solution to infection: quarantine, but by the time you recognize the problem, it is often too late. Alola Montes overwhelms you with her forceful personality. Cassius intrigues you with his confiding nature and the depth of his feelings. How can you protect yourself against such insidious viruses? The answer lies in judging people on the effects they have on the world and not on the reasons they give for their prop image. A virus. Unseen, it lems. Infectors can be recognized by the misfortune they draw on them, enters your force without selves, their turbulent past, their long line of broken relationships, their unwarning, spreading silently in stable careers, and the very force of their character, which sweeps you up slowly before you are aware of and makes you lose your reason. Be forewarned by these signs of the infection, it is deep inside you. Tor. Learn to see the discontent in their eye. Most important of all, do not take pity. Do not enmesh yourself in trying to help. The infector will remain unchanged, but you will be unhinged. The other side of infection is equally valid, and perhaps more readily understood. There are people who attract happiness to themselves by their good cheer, natural buoyancy, and intelligence. They are a source of pleasure, and you must associate with them to share in the prosperity they draw upon themselves. This applies to more than good cheer and success. All positive qualities can infect us. Talleyrand had many strange and intimidating traits, but most agreed that he surpassed all Frenchmen in graciousness, aristocratic charm, and wit. Indeed, he came from one of the oldest noble families in the country, and despite his belief in democracy and the French Republic, he retained his courtly manners. His contemporary Napoleon was in many ways the opposite: a peasant from Corsica, taciturn and ungracious, even violent. There was no one Napoleon admired more than Talleyrand. He envied his minister's way with people, his wit and his ability to charm women, and as best he could, he kept Talleyrand around him, hoping to soak up the culture he lacked. There is no doubt that Napoleon changed as his rule continued. Many of the rough edges were smoothed by his constant association with Talleyrand. Used a positive side of this emotional osmosis to advantage. If, for example, you are miserly by nature, you will never go beyond a certain limit. Only generous souls attain greatness. Associate with the generous, then, and they will infect you, opening up everything that is tight and restricted in you. If you are gloomy, gravitate to the cheerful. If you are prone to isolation, force yourself to befriend the gregarious. Never associate with those who share your defects. They will reinforce everything that holds you back. Only create associations with positive affinities. Make this a rule of life and you will benefit more than from all the therapy in the world. Authority. Recognize the fortunate so that you may choose their company, and the unfortunate so that you may avoid them. Misfortune is usually the crime of folly, and among those who suffer from it there is no malady more contagious. Never open your door to the least of misfortunes, for, if you do, many others will follow in its train. Do not die of another's misery. Balthazar Gratian, 1601-1658. Reversal. This law admits of no reversal. Its application is universal. There is nothing to be gained by associating with those who infect you with their misery. There is only power and good fortune to be obtained by associating with the fortunate. Ignore this law at your peril. Law 11. Learn to keep people dependent on you. Judgment. To maintain your independence, you must always be needed and wanted. The more you are relied on, the more freedom you have. Make people depend on you for their happiness and prosperity and you have nothing to fear. Never teach them enough so that they can do without you. Transgression of the law. Sometime in the Middle Ages, a mercenary soldier, a condottiere, whose name has not been recorded, saved the town of Siena from a foreign aggressor. How could the good citizens of Siena reward him? No amount of money or honor could possibly compare in value to the preservation of a city's liberty. The citizens thought of making the mercenary the lord of the city, but even that, they decided, wasn't recompense enough. At last one of them stood before the assembly called to debate this matter and said, "Let us kill him and then worship him as our patron saint." And so they did. The Count of Carmagnola was one of the bravest and most successful of all the condottieri. In 1442, late in his life, he was in the employ of the city of Venice, which was in the midst of a long war with Florence. The Count was suddenly recalled to Venice, a favorite of the people. He was received there with all kinds of honor and splendor. That evening he was to dine with the Doge himself, in the Doge's palace. On the way into the palace, however, he noticed that the guard was leading him in a different direction from usual. Crossing the famous Bridge of Sighs, he suddenly realized where they were taking him to the dungeon. He was convicted on a trumped-up charge and the next day in the Piazza San Marco, before a horrified crowd who could not understand how his fate had changed so drastically. He was beheaded. The two horses were carrying two loads. The front horse went well, but the rear horse was lazy. The men began to pile the rear horse's load on the front horse. When they had transferred it all, the rear horse found it easy going, and he said to the front horse, "Toil and sweat. The more you try, the more you have to suffer." When they reached the tavern, the owner said, "Why should I fodder two horses when I carry all on one? I had better give the one all the food it wants, and cut the throat of the other. At least I shall have the hide." And so he did. Fables. Leo Tolstoy, 1828-1910. Interpretation. Many of the great condottieri of Renaissance Italy suffered the same fate as the patron saint of Siena and the Count of Carmagnola. They won battle after battle for their employers only to find themselves banished, imprisoned, or executed. The problem was not ingratitude. It was that there were so many other condottieri as able and valiant as they were replaceable. Nothing was lost by killing them. Meanwhile, the older among them had grown powerful themselves, and wanted more and more money for their services. How much better, then, to do away with them and hire a younger, cheaper mercenary? That was the fate of the Count of Carmagnola, who had started to act impudently and independently. He had taken his power for granted without making sure that he was truly indispensable. Such is the fate, to a less violent degree, one hopes, of those who do not make others dependent on them. Sooner or later someone comes along who can do the job as well as they can. Someone younger, fresher, less expensive, less threatening. Be the only one who can do what you do, and make the fate of those who hire you so entwined with yours that they cannot possibly get rid of you. Otherwise you will someday be forced to cross your own bridge of sighs. Observance of the law. When Otto von Bismarck became a deputy in the Prussian Parliament in 1847, he was 32 years old and without an ally or friend. Looking around him, he decided that the side to ally himself with was not the Parliament's liberals or conservatives, not any particular minister, and certainly not the people. It was with the king, Frederick William. This was an odd choice to say the least, for Frederick was at a low point of his power. A weak, indecisive man, he consistently gave in to the liberals in Parliament. In fact, he was spineless, and stood for much that Bismarck disliked, personally and politically. Yet Bismarck courted Frederick night and day. When other deputies attacked the king for his many inept moves, only Bismarck stood by him. The cat that walked by himself. Then the woman laughed and set the cat a bowl of the warm white milk and said, "Zero cat, you are as clever as a man, but remember that your bargain was not made with the man or the dog, and I do not know what they will do when they come home." "What is it to me?" said the cat. "If I have my place in the cave by the fire and my warm white milk three times a day, I do not care what the man or the dog can do." And from that day to this, best beloved, three proper men out of five will always throw things at a cat whenever they meet him, and all proper dogs will chase him up a tree. But the cat keeps his side of the bargain too. He will kill mice, and he will be kind to babies when he is in the house, just as long as they do not pull his tail too hard. But when he have done that, and between times, and when the moon gets up and the night comes, he is the cat that walks by himself, and all places are alike to him. Then he goes out to the wet wild woods or up the wet wild trees or on the wet wild roofs, waving his wild tail and walking by his wild lone. Just so stories. Rudyard Kipling, 1865-1936. Finally, it all paid off. In 1851 Bismarck was made a minister in the king's cabinet. Now he went to work. Time and again he forced the king's hand, getting him to build up the military, to stand up to the liberals, to do exactly as Bismarck wished. He worked on Frederick's insecurity about his manliness, challenging him to be firm and to rule with pride. And he slowly restored the king's powers until the monarchy was once again the most powerful force in Prussia. When Frederick died, in 1861, his brother William assumed the throne. William disliked Bismarck intensely and had no intention of keeping him around. But he also inherited the same situation his brother had, enemies galore, who wanted to nibble his power away. He actually considered abdicating, feeling he lacked the strength to deal with this dangerous and precarious position. But Bismarck insinuated himself once again. He stood by the new king, gave him strength, and urged him into firm and decisive action. The king grew dependent on Bismarck's strong-arm tactics to keep his enemies at bay, and despite his antipathy toward the man, he soon made him his prime minister. The two quarreled often over policy. Bismarck was much more conservative, but the king understood his own dependency. Whenever the prime minister threatened to resign, the king gave in to him, time after time. It was in fact Bismarck who set state policy. Years later, Bismarck's actions as Prussia's prime minister led the various German states to be united into one country. Now Bismarck finagled the king into letting himself be crowned Emperor of Germany. Yet it was really Bismarck who had reached the heights of power. As right-hand man to the emperor, and as imperial chancellor and knighted prince, he pulled all the levers. Interpretation. Most young and ambitious politicians looking out on the political landscape of 1840s Germany would have tried to build a power base among those with the most power. Bismarck saw different. Joining forces with the powerful can be foolish. They will swallow you up, just as the Doge of Venice swallowed up the Count of Carmagnola. No one will come to depend on you if they are already strong. If you are ambitious, it is much wiser to seek out weak rulers or masters with whom you can create a relationship of dependency. You become their strength, their intelligence, their spine. What power you hold. If they got rid of you, the whole edifice would collapse. Necessity rules the world. People rarely act unless compelled to. If you create no need for yourself, then you will be done away with at first opportunity. If, on the other hand, you understand the laws of power and make others depend on you for their welfare, if you can counteract their weakness with your own iron and blood, in Bismarck's phrase, then you will survive your masters as Bismarck did. You will have all the benefits of power without the thorns that come from being a master. Thus a wise prince will think of ways to keep his citizens of every sort and under every circumstance dependent on the state and on him. And then they will always be trustworthy. Niccolò Machiavelli, 1469-1527. The IIMIRI and the AND. An extravagant young vine, vainly ambitious of independence, and fond of rambling at large, despised the alliance of a slately elm that grew near, and courted her embraces. Having risen to some small height without any kind of support, she shot forth her flimsy branches to a very uncommon and superfluous length, calling on her neighbor to take notice how little she wanted his assistance. Poor infatuated shrub, replied the elm, how inconsistent is thy conduct. Wouldst thou be truly independent, thou shouldst carefully apply those juices to the enlargement of thy stem, which thou lavishest in vain upon unnecessary foliage. I shortly shall behold thee groveling on the ground, yet countenanced, indeed, by many of the human race, who, intoxicated with vanity, have despised economy, and who, to support for a moment their empty boast of independence, have exhausted the very source of it in frivolous expenses. Fables, Robert Dodsley, 1703-1764. Keys to power. The ultimate power is the power to get people to do as you wish. When you can do this without having to force people or hurt them, when they willingly grant you what you desire, then your power is untouchable. The best way to achieve this position is to create a relationship of dependence. The master requires your services. He is weak or unable to function without you. You have enmeshed yourself in his work so deeply that doing away with you would bring him great difficulty, or at least would mean valuable time lost in training another to replace you. Once such a relationship is established, you have the upper hand, the leverage to make the master do as you wish. It is the classic case of the man behind the throne, the servant of the king who actually controls the king. Bismarck did not have to bully either Frederick or William into doing his bidding. He simply made it clear that unless he got what he wanted, he would walk away, leaving the king to twist in the wind. Both kings soon danced to Bismarck's tune. Do not be one of the many who mistakenly believe that the ultimate form of power is independence. Power involves a relationship between people. You will always need others as allies, pawns, or even as weak masters who serve as your front. The completely independent man would live in a cabin in the woods. He would have the freedom to come and go as he pleased, but he would have no power. The best you can hope for is that others will grow so dependent on you that you enjoy a kind of reverse independence. Their need for you frees you. Louis XI, 1423-1483, the great spider king of France, had a weakness for astrology. He kept a court astrologer whom he admired, until one day the man predicted that a lady of the court would die within 8 days. When the prophecy came true, Louis was terrified, thinking that either the man had murdered the woman to prove his accuracy or that he was so versed in his science that his powers threatened Louis himself. In either case, he had to be killed. One evening, Louis summoned the astrologer to his room, high in the castle. Before the man arrived, the king told his servants that when he gave the signal, they were to pick the astrologer up, carry him to the window, and tell him to the ground, hundreds of feet below. The astrologer soon arrived, but before giving the signal, Louis decided to ask him one last question. "You claim to understand astrology and to know the fate of others, so tell me what your fate will be and how long you have to live." "I shall die just 3 days before your majesty," the astrologer replied.